Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Health and Sport Committee in 2017. Could I ask everyone in the room to ensure their mobile phones are on silent? It's acceptable to use mobile devices for social media, but please do not take photographs or film proceedings. As you'll see from our agenda, we've already covered agenda items 1 and 2 in private, so we now move on to agenda item 3. Item 3 is a decision on taking agenda item 7 in private at this and future meetings. Agenda item 7 is consideration of a draft letter to the Scottish Health Council. Such items are usually taken in private. Are we agreed? Thank you. I understand one of our witnesses may be delayed. I don't know if it's travel or whatever, so I'm suggesting that we maybe suspend proceedings until he arrives, if everyone's in agreement with that. Is that okay? Hopefully it should be a short suspension, so I suspend, hopefully briefly. Okay, folks, we are going to proceed. Agenda item four is two evidence sessions on child protection in sport. The first evidence session is looking specifically at football. Just to make you aware, the Parliament's photographer will be taking photographs during this session. Can I welcome to the committee Fraser Wishart, Chief Executive, Professional Footballers Association Scotland, Andrew McKinley, Chief Operating Officer of Scottish Football Association, Donna Martin, Child Protection and Safeguarding Manager, Scottish Football Association. David Little, the Chief Exec of the Scottish Youth Football Association, is stuck on the M8 somewhere and hopefully will join us at some point, but we're going to proceed because we don't actually know his precise location. So, before moving to questions, can I remind members and witnesses that for the purposes of the standing order rule on sub judice, no mention should be made to any live ongoing cases during the evidence session, or to any issues that which might prejudice those cases. Could I have the first question from Marie Todd?
Thank you, Convener. In actual fact, my first question was directed at Mr. Little from the Scottish Youth Football Association, so hopefully the others at the table will be able to answer it for me. I noticed from the written submission that there were 2,500 coaches in that organisation in December that weren't PVG checked, which is about 16% of the coaches working for that organisation. I wondered if you would be able to tell me what might be the barriers to disclosure or what might be the explanation for that number of coaches working in that particular sport. I know you can't answer for that particular organisation, but what barriers generally there might be to getting PVG checked.
Firstly, can I just thank the convener and the committee for inviting us along this morning, particularly myself and Donna on behalf of the Scottish Football Association. You're right that the main part of your question, Mr. Little, will need to answer it. Donna will give you a bit more information on disclosure and where there might be issues. What I would say is, on behalf of the Scottish FA, where we have obligations to have PVG checks done, we are fully compliant with that. We also, I think you've seen in your evidence pack, that we issued last year a directive to all our members around their compliance with a number of matters in this area, including PVG checks. In relation to our senior clubs, we have since 2011, since PVG checks came in, fully audited them through our club licensing regime to make sure that they are fully compliant. And if other members are not compliant, we will use the powers that we've given ourselves under the directive. The ones you are talking about are very much the Scottish Youth FA, and therefore it would be appropriate, or will be appropriate, for Mr. Little to respond on those. In relation to your particular question around barriers to disclosure, Donna, I don't know if you want to say anything about that.
Sure. I guess across any of the kind of sporting organisations, in relation to what we all have in place for appointment and selection of people into regulated work with children, there's been a lot of progress, and I think there's a lot of good practice in place. In the sense of, I guess, the procedure that we have, it's actually wider than just doing PVG checks. We want to ensure, because we do recognise that a PVG doesn't necessarily mean that an individual's safe. It could just be that they haven't been caught yet. So the way that we approach that in a wider sense is that it's not just a PVG that's carried out, there's also a self-declaration form. We also carry out two references on the individual, which in fact one of the questions within that is if they have any concerns about that individual working with children. We then take an individual through induction, ensure that within the 3 months of appointment they are receiving training in our children's wellbeing, dependent on the level of activity they're doing within our association. And as part of that, that's around their understanding and knowledge of what our policies and procedures are. And ultimately, there's kind of two ways to do that safeguarding practice. At that point of appointment, when we're bringing somebody in, but it's then the ongoing monitoring. So as part of that, what we also have is a code of conduct, which every individual signs up to, where it's clearly stressed what good conduct's expected, what practice should be avoided, and the unacceptable conduct, with a view that they then physically sign up to that. So that at any stage, anything inappropriate is identified, there's no claim back of, well, I wouldn't have understood that that wasn't okay because they've physically signed that document. So that's a practice that we have in place within our own association. And like everything else, it can be a period of change to get the best practice there. But in terms of obstacles, it is just that sense of bringing everybody along with you. And generally what we have put within our own appointment and selection procedure is, as Andrew mentions, is within our directive. So that's what we're looking for, the rest of football, because ultimately what we're trying to do is get that consistency.
Thank you. I would agree with you that the PVG check isn't the entirety of safeguarding children. It is, however, a very important cornerstone. And I see from the figures that the BBC have made public this morning that your organisation still has over 1,000 coaches not PVG checked. So is it
then the Scottish Football Association?
The Scottish Youth Football Association.
So they've got it on the table wrong.
It's not ourselves. We're fully compliant.
Okay, so 100% of your coaches are PVG checked. Okay, that's great. So you mentioned in your answer about auditing the information. How do you do that, and what consequences can there be for organisations which aren't compliant?
I'll start with the club licensing. The club licensing goes out every year to clubs, and we'll check a number of things, and it will check whether one of the things it checks in this is what they have in place around child protection procedures, appropriate PVG checks. If they are in breach, that will be reported up to the licensing committee, which in turn can be reported to our compliance officer through our judicial panel, which has a variety of punishments it could inflict. The directive is slightly different. The directive, which is much wider, which we brought in for all our members, which would also apply to the Youth Football Association and also then ultimately to their members. Again, if there is non-compliance, and we will be monitoring non-compliance, that will be passed to the compliance officer, again, to go through our independent judicial panel process. And they have a number of different punishments that they can mete out.
So what, could you give me some examples?
Oh, it can go from anything from a fine up to expulsion.
Okay. Thank you.
What the relationship is between the SFA and the Youth Association?
Of course. The Scottish Youth Football Association is an affiliated association of the Scottish Football Association. There are a number of affiliated national associations, which you have the juniors, the amateurs, the schoolboys, the women's, and the welfare and the Youth Football Association. They are an independent organisation. They're their own corporate entity and run their own affairs, but they are an affiliated national association.
And is there funding comes from SFA down to them?
There is funding that we provide to them, yes.
But you don't oversee compliance?
We do oversee compliance. That's why we've brought in our directive. To make sure that we can absolutely oversee compliance.
If there's 1,000 unregistered coaches at their level,
we have made sure, we have said that they have to have that in place by a certain time, and if not, we will be passing that to our compliance officer.
But when did you do that?
We put that in place. That directive came in October last year.
So prior to that, obviously compliance wasn't working.
Well, Prior to that, we were aware of the issue and we offered to assist them with fixing the issue that they had. But you need to ask Mr. Little where they were with that.
No, but if you're overseeing them, if you're overseeing compliance and they're not complying, then there's a problem within the system, isn't there?
Well, I think that's probably something for the independent review to consider. But certainly we've done everything within our powers, and we have the directive now which gives us greater powers, and we will be enforcing that directive.
Alison.
Convener.
You may come
back to that. I think we well may come back to that. I think there are clearly concerns that at the level of some of the most vulnerable participants, there is this gap, with proper certification and safeguarding. And it sort of, it leads us to be concerned that assurances still couldn't be given today, that we were moving away from the culture that has led to the, you know, the disturbing facts that bring us to be discussing this issue in detail today. I mean, can you give us any assurance that action's been taken to embed that cultural change?
Of course. I think there's a very valid statement in Children First in their response about the creation of a culture that does value children. In this regard, there are a number of things that we've done, and we put those in our response. I think probably passed it to Donna, who will give you some of those examples of areas that we've done to make sure that we do go to creating that culture.
Back in 2014, when I was coming into post, what had been carried out by Dr. Sue Hamilton at the time was a review into child protection practices across Scottish football. The gaps that had been identified then became the recommendations that I picked up coming into post. With my background and experience of working both with the Safeguarding and Sports Service, with Children First, and also with NSPCC Scotland, my understanding of GIRFEC, of Shinari indicators, of children's rights, and being able to work in partnership with the various organisations who were the experts, became the kind of fundamental parts of updating policies and procedures and widening out, and I guess pretty much trying to start to give people confidence, because when we talk about the scary world of child protection, there's either people are just unsure what to do, they're nervous about putting themselves in a situation, they don't want that responsibility of taking the wrong action on behalf of children. And so we felt that this was an opportunity to one, demonstrate how children's wellbeing and our practice within sport can actually impact children's wellbeing in the widest sense, but look at that continuum from wellbeing to protection and demonstrate sport's role within that. So when we updated our policies and procedures, they were very much written from a children's rights-based approach. And that's not just about what's in the policy documents. It's then been about what we have carried out in the sense of training. So the training that we've delivered over 2015, 2016 and already begun this year ranges from a two-hour organisational awareness, which is for any member of staff, recognising that people have their own families and friends who will have children. We then deliver a three-hour training for people who are in regulated work or will manage people who are in regulated work with children. And that's very much getting that understanding of children's rights, knowing what we're talking about in the sense of the wellbeing indicators.
Can I ask about the children themselves?
Yes.
And what action has been taken to raise awareness amongst children and young people about how to keep themselves safe and what is acceptable?
Of course.
Undoubtedly, you know, coaches are in a position of great influence,
yep,
and, you know, potentially power. And if you have young people who are, you know, dependent on you as to whether or not you get a place in a team, you know, there is a real power imbalance there. So I'd like to understand what, you know, information is being shared with young people about what is appropriate and inappropriate and how that information is being shared.
Of course. I guess just finishing up on what the training that was there, because it was essential that our staff and our volunteers had that understanding of what was good conduct and what was best practice. The next stage was then delivering training to our young players. So at the moment, I think when this was published back on the 20th of January, we were in the region of 1,200 players. We've since delivered training over the last couple of weeks to another couple of hundred young players. And that's the sense of, one, knowing what policies and procedures are, recognising that they have a voice. It's around their social media understanding and awareness, both about how to keep themselves safe, but recognising the power that can be used with social media as well. We also carry out consultation with our young players. So we've done that in different avenues. One, we carried out an online confidential survey for Club Academy Scotland players who are registered with our professional clubs. That was carried out back in 2015, and that gave the opportunity for them to be completely honest about their experiences within their football clubs so that we were able to learn what was working and what needed addressed. That has then informed the training that we're putting in place. Furthermore, for all our players who are in our performance schools, our girls' squads and our boys' squads, we do face-to-face consultation, and that's on a yearly basis. So the outcome of that discussion, we have a children's rights and wellbeing officer who has picked up where I had started with that, And it's then anything that we're learning from our players is then fed into whether it be that performance school or whether it be the squad, so that they can understand that we're listening, that we're taking on board any suggestions, we're recognising when things are going well too, but ultimately that they're feeling that they're involved. And I guess one of the key things that I remember from the very first survey that we done with an under-18 squad was the comments of a 17-year-old young man, where when I first introduced Shanae indicators, I wasn't sure what they were going to understand by that, but we were asking them to give feedback on how they felt being part of a national performance squad, travelling abroad and representing their country. And one of the things that he mentioned around included was how included he felt as part of his Scotland squad, whether it be from the airport arriving, being part of that process, the preparation for games and communication mm-hmm. across between coaches. And how he didn't feel that in any other part of his life, but that's what he was getting out of football, that he was included in that whole process.
Thank you. I appreciate your comments there. I think I'm still struggling, probably like the convener is, with this sort of disjoint between the youth side of things, who seem to have this, it looks fairly relaxed approach to ensuring that everyone is as safe as we can guarantee on paper at least. And probably to Mr. Wishart and Mr. McKinley, I think one of the heartbreaking aspects of this news has been the fact that it's taken so many players such a long time to come forward with their information. Do you think we're seeing a shift that would enable people to come forward far earlier? Because living with that kind of burden must be truly intolerable. Do you think that the policies that are being put in place would enable a young person to come forward at a far earlier stage, instead of thinking, I'm going to live with this for 20 years or so?
I do. I can only imagine the suffering that these people have gone through and are going through. I think football mirrors society. We've seen a lot happen over the last few years in this area, and football is no different. And I would encourage those that haven't come forward, if they feel able to come forward, and the police have done that, we've done that, and I would continue to encourage them to come forward, whether that's through the NSPCC, through the police, through ourselves, through PFA Scotland. I think that's important if they feel able to.
Good morning. Thank you again for the opportunity to perhaps inform this process. Just a bit of explanation, our interest has always been for our members who are professional footballers. That's who we represent. So in terms of the youth side, it's not really been part of our remit, but over the last couple of years, we've found more and more parents coming forward, especially from Club Academy Scotland players, and parents looking for advice generally around regulations, around compensation, around the rights of their individuals. So it's become an area where we have become involved. We have a youth football advisory service, which is basically around our lawyers, and we took a call yesterday from a lad's parents who had an issue with registration and wanted things explained. That was passed to our lawyers, who then explained it. So we are kind of involved now in youth football, and I think it's only right that we are involved. In terms of this child protection and sport discussion, we really became involved in this side when the stories came out, and I think you're right that it's a horrific time, and we have to encourage and create a safe environment for people to come forward. That's where we've really seen our role. There is Police Scotland, there is the Scottish FA, and if we can just provide an alternative route or a bit of comfort for people to come forward, then I think that's absolutely vitally important. It's a really huge issue. We're going to discuss this here, and I'm sure elsewhere as well. There's the review, there's a Police Scotland investigation, but we can't take the focus off the individual. And I think that the players who came forward in England showed huge bravery, and sometimes it just takes one person to come forward. And of course, in England, they've had the high-profile player who's come forward, one of four or five of them now who are well-known, a couple of England internationals. We've not had that in Scotland. Now, is that because or the environment? Is it because there's not support there? I don't know. We tried to make that public to say that we believe that there isn't an environment to come forward in terms of the NSPCC hotline, or as Andrew says, phone the Scottish FA, phone us directly. We feel only a small number of calls. But I do think there is an issue around the media profile as well. I think that is very, very difficult. Scotland is a very, football so high profile. And I think that might be an issue. How deep it is, I think we can only guess. But certainly anecdotally, as I've said in my evidence, that there are, I've been told, ex-professionals who are not willing to come forward because they are a wee bit frightened of the environment, they're frightened of what happens to them next. Do they have to go and speak to the police? Do they have to give evidence in court? What happens if it reaches the newspapers, etc.? So that's where I think football has as a key role as well, and ourselves in partnership with the Scottish FA. With regards to younger people, I think it's a very difficult environment, if you're suggesting, for a young person to come forward. I don't think it's changed. I don't think football's unique to that. I think when you look at youth groups, you look at churches, you look at schools, you look at any environment where adults have a position where they have a position of power, if you like, or influence over a young person, it can be difficult for a young person to come forward and feel in that safe environment. So I don't think that's unique to football. I think that's something that perhaps your committee might look at wider in sport, and certainly in wider in society as well. So I think football's no different from anywhere else.
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. And I'd like to pick up a little bit on what Mr Bishop and Mr McKinley were saying there about football being no different and mirroring society. The Children and Young People's Commissioner, in a report in May 2015, said that his main concern was the power imbalance and unfair treatment of children involved in football. And I think recognising that power imbalance there with children and football clubs, what steps have your organisations taken to redress that imbalance?
I'll take it initially, and then Jordana will pick up as well. We've worked through another committee, through the Public Petitions Committee. There's been issues raised around some of our registration procedures. We've been in correspondence with the Commissioner and others for a period of 18 months. We also had the Commissioner at our convention, where we debated these matters, and we've brought about some changes to those registration procedures. I know there's still a view that that balance is still too much in one direction, and that is an ongoing debate that we are having and will continue to have. Donna, if you want to add,
of course,
generally,
significantly the big difference being around the creation of the Young Players Wellbeing Panel, because what is still outstanding in the sense of registration and ensuring that children's rights are being realised is that if a child is facing any issues with their registration, if they are wanting to leave their professional football club, but because of the processes that are in place around training compensation, and there isn't that ability for clubs to be able to come to an agreement with that, we do have the facility for young players to come to our wellbeing panel. And that is a panel where there are three members. One has the background from a legal perspective, one has the background from a football perspective, and one has the children's rights and wellbeing background. And the purpose of that panel is to make a decision and help mediate the process in the best interests of the young player. What we do understand that this is very little actual cases would ever be raised. In fact, our panel has yet to be convened since it was put into place at the beginning of this season.
So there's been no complaints have been raised with that panel. Gone to that panel. Because that's interesting, because in the evidence that the Children's Commissioner has provided to the committee today, and he's coming along at the next session, so it'd be interesting to chat with him then, was that when children had raised complaints with clubs, they had been told to leave. And they had subsequent to that, they had then made complaint to the Children's Commissioner. So I'm intrigued as to why they wouldn't have gone through the process, if it is a simple process to go through with yourselves.
It's perhaps been timing, but also in the sense of my understanding on the group or the numbers of people that have either approached the Commissioner or research has been carried out by his office, has been a very, very small percentage of young players who are actually in those registration processes with professional clubs. The research that we carried out reached over 190 young players who are involved in that process. And what came out very clear from that is that over 90% of them knew what to do if they did have a concern and they did want to leave their club. 75% of them were...
But I'm not necessarily talking about people, sorry to interrupt you, it's okay. Leaving clubs. I'm talking about them raising concerns, in particular child protection concerns.
Yeah, and I suppose my experience of that, or my experience of working with children and young people, is actually that a coach is someone that they have a very close relationship with. In the 3 years before coming to this post with the NSPCC, I was involved with the Childline School Service. We visited Primary 6 and Primary 7 pupils. And the activities that we carried out there were around identifying the different types of abuse and bullying and the steps that they could take to keep themselves safe. And one of the key things that came... Sorry, I will get to the point. One of the key things that came out when we were identifying people who they trusted that they would talk to were their sports coaches. That's who they would go to with something that was happening in their personal life. So in terms of what our current practice is in clubs, clubs have had named contacts for child protection officers for a number of years. The policies and procedures are there, not just about responding to the concerns of a child, so if a coach is worried, but it's about responding to concerns about the conduct of an adult as well.
I hear what you say, the policies and procedures are there, but it's about the power imbalance. So I'm not hearing anything that's reassuring me that that power imbalance is necessarily being recalibrated.
I suppose in the sense of the approach that we're taking with our training, I believe that what we are doing around training our coaches and training people who are in our professional clubs about what a children's rights-based approach is, it's about creating that safe environment. And what we understand just now, and because I handle concerns that come in the Scottish Football Association, I also support professional clubs where players and parents and carers have spoke out about handling concerns as well. I see that practice taking place. So I suppose I still believe in the sense of young people who are suffering and having the confidence and trust in others to speak out is always going to be a challenge. And again, not just in football. But I do believe that young players have that opportunity and know who to go to in their clubs if they do want to say something.
Alex. Good morning to the panel. I should start by declaring an interest that between 2006 and 2008, I sat on the Voluntary Sector Issues Unit of the Government Implementation Group for the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Act. That act came into force in 2007, or was passed in 2007, and came into force shortly after. At that point, all new entrants or all new people being employed either in a paid or voluntary basis in a regulated childcare position had to go through PVG. There followed a three-year process of managed retrospective checking for people who already had enhanced disclosure. My first question is specifically to a point that Andrew McKinley raised. Mr. McKinley, you said quite clearly that you issued a directive, your organisation issued a directive in October last year to all affiliated bodies about PVG checking. I can only imagine that the catalyst for that was the outbreak of the revelations.
No, it was pre that.
It was pre that.
I went to our board in August, like it was pre this.
Right. Nevertheless, we're talking about an offence here, that it's an offence to employ somebody who is barred from working with children. The only way you can get through that is through PVG and checking. And I wanted to ask about why has it taken nearly 10 years to get to this level of compliance where it's a directive in October to affiliated bodies? Why was there not such a directive in 2007 or 2008?
I'll let Donna pick up the specific point in a second, but I'll start off with the first point. The Scottish Youth Football Association is an independent organisation who oversees their checks of their own membership. They have their own member clubs. So you very much need to put the question to Mr. Little as to what they've done to ensure within their member clubs that there has been compliance. These are their member clubs, not our member clubs. They have their own disciplinary system, and I'll be interested to hear how they have taken those clubs through the disciplinary system who have not been in compliance. We were concerned.
Don't you speak to them?
Sorry, we do speak to them. We became.
So if he tells us, will that be a revelation that you've just hearing today?
Well, no, because it's come out over
so
the last few months.
So
the numbers
you already
have,
know.
The numbers have come out over the last couple of months of the checks that they haven't done. We were concerned last summer around what we and Donna's talked about over the 2-3 years she's been in, the work she's done to bring about best practice across the game, to help across the game. But we were concerned that although there was some good practice across the game, there was a lack of consistency. And that's where we felt we had certain powers around our member clubs, but we wanted to ensure that we had stronger powers across the board where that lack of consistency continued, which is why we brought in the directive to give us those stronger powers. But as I say, they are independent, they have the first responsibility, and I think it is very important that you hear from Mr. Little on that point.
Yeah, I think it's very frustrating we don't have unless this is this Mr. Little? Fantastic. Shall I just wait till the witness just carry on? Okay. Can I ask then, just to follow up on that, Mr. McKinley? You did say that compliance is your organisation's responsibility to check that the affiliated bodies are compliant.
We need to check that they're compliant with their own checks. They need to check that their own members are compliant.
Right.
And this is their own members as I understand it, where the lack of compliance has been, as opposed to them not being compliant. But as I say, Mr. Little should be able to.
And while Mr. Little gathers himself, can you just tell me what kind of measures you did over the last 10 years in terms of monitoring compliance in your affiliated bodies? Well, I mean, before this directive came out, was there ever discussion with the sort of senior management of these organisations as to where they were on their journey in terms of full checking and the rest of it?
We did have discussions, and we offered to assist where appropriate. We said that if there were issues, we were happy to assist them with compliance.
Can I direct to Mr. Little? Mr. Little, I'm sorry to catch you just as you're settling yourself. Welcome to the committee this morning. We've been discussing checking and the lack thereof within coaches, both in your organisation and others. The Protection of Vulnerable Groups Act was brought in 2007, and it was designed so that there was a mechanism to replace the disclosure checking, so that the offence organisations would not be guilty of the offence of employing in either a paid or voluntary position a volunteer or member of staff who was in a regulated childcare position who was barred from working with children, and you do that through the PVG system. So it would be an offence to employ somebody who was barred, and that's how we have PVG. But we've all learned that in terms of coaching among children, that there are over 1,000 such coaches who don't have proper checks within your organisation. Can you explain to us why that is?
Firstly, could I apologise to everyone present? And I would not recommend 3 hours in the M8 so early in the morning. So profound apologies. I think it would be important to give you some background in respect of SYFA, and I'll be very brief. SYFA has 7 regions. We've got 39 member leagues. We've got 3,500 clubs. And as of yesterday, 15,433 registered officials. We have 60,000 registered players. We have 6 full-time staff and 1 part-time staff to administrate that. We have a churn of anywhere between 30 and 40% of our members on a yearly basis, which causes great difficulties. It's not as if we've got members that are going to be there, the same membership year in, year out. So that has caused us difficulties, and that is why there will always be this churn. There will always be people to be checked. For example, this particular playing season, 16-17, ends in June. We will have people coming and going right up to that particular deadline. And I think this is indicative of sport in general, as opposed to just football, that there is this churn of officials. We currently... are in a position where we're going through, we anticipate that we'll do 800, between 800 and 1,000 checks per month. One of the things that didn't help us was in the early days where there was a cap on the amount of checks that that could take place. So again, when you have a cap, a blockage at the front end, it builds up. But I would just like to commend all our volunteers. We have 238 additional signatories across the country. And I apologise if I'm trying to tell my grannies how to suck eggs here. But the process is that a person comes into to SYFA, and the recruitment process at club level is key to this whole thing. If they get it right using local knowledge, and predominantly within the local communities, there will be knowledge. They also have the ability to speak to other clubs in membership and say, this particular person has turned up at our club. He's indicating that he was previously at your club. Have you got any background? Why did he leave your club? We've written into our selection and application procedures that they should pursue references on behalf of these people. At that particular time, any official of that type would be given provisional membership. With provisional membership comes the proviso that they cannot be left to supervise children. They then go through the registration process. They attend a league meeting where these 238 officials go through, check their forums, check that they've got all the identification with them. And at that particular stage, they would then submit to SYFA. We have our own registration system where we capture all of these details. You made reference earlier to disclosure checks, the old POXA. We've still got information on our records of POXA. We have been doing this for 15 years. Once the checks come in, go through the system, they then go to Disclosure Services at Volunteer Scotland, and then subsequently to Disclosure Scotland for the actual checks. Can I say, and put on record again, the assistance that we have received from Disclosure Services in particular over the last 15 years has been phenomenal. They're a phenomenal group of people through there and have aided the process right back to the days of John Harris. So again, we've been in at the beginning, and this is the type of work we're doing. I reckon that this year disclosure checks will cost SYFA £70,000. Sorry, I was long-winded.
No, that's fine. Very helpful. Thank you for that, and absolutely agree that there is no substitute for safe recruitment on top of disclosure and PVG checking. However, what concerns me is that the weak link in the chain in this, in your very fulsome evidence, I thank you for that, is the description of what happens while coaches are waiting for the PVG check to come through. This point where we make sure that they're never in an unsupervised capacity with young people on the field. Now,
yep.
I accept that there needs to be tolerance, there needs to be an understanding of how this works, but I would suggest that's a risk, and that actually, you know, knowing my son's football club, there are many times in an evening where one of the two or three coaches has to go and help a child in the changing room or has to look after the kids on the field. That doesn't seem to me like a guarantee that we can be absolutely sure that we're protecting kids from risk in this. And that's why generally, you know, particularly in the sporting environment, the regulated childcare position is so stringently monitored as to where that lies. And I think that the Scottish Football Association agree, and that's why they've issued the directive that they did in October, that you can't have people. Can you also explain what that directive is, Mr. McKinley?
Yeah, probably Donna can explain better for you on that.
Of course. It's it's taking it wider. Of course, definitely, there needs to be the requirements for PVG checks to be taking place. I do think there are ways that we can support SYFA in that process, as David's outlined, because of the time that it does take from that point at the club to get that into SYFA, yep, to get that through that process. So I do think there are measures that and
but the directive would suggest that you as an organisation are not satisfied with the SYFA.
We feel there's a lack of consistency, yeah, potentially across the membership, which is why we've issued the directive. Is not just for the SYFA, the directive is across our membership, yeah, and we want to make sure that, as I said a minute ago, a lot of good work Donna has done in her 3 years in post, helping members, helping them to be compliant, to come up to standard. But we want to absolutely take this to the next stage and ensure that there's that consistency across the game.
And Mr. Little, how do you respond to that, and how achievable do you think that complying with the directive from the SFA will be?
Well, we have a meeting on the 17th of this month with the SFA to discuss the directive. In respect of the directive, what we need to ensure is that the paperwork in its totality, and I reckon that there would be 112,000 pieces of paper to implement the directive. So what we're going to discuss with Donna is how we can get technology to work for us. We have websites, we've got Facebook, we've got Twitter, and we're going to use these tools to gather that information and gather it in a manageable format. But the one thing that I would say about protection, and can I say within SYFA, there's zero tolerance in respect of abusive behaviour towards children. But there's a number of people have got responsibilities. Parents have got responsibilities to check out that club. And on our website, we have questions that parents should ask when they attend any club to determine their suitability. The clubs have got responsibility to carry out the local recruitment. The leagues have responsibility to ensure that we have vetting evenings where people can come along. We issue a full report to every league every month with every official that's affiliated to SYFA. SYFA have responsibilities to ensure that we've got the correct processes in place. So by team working and everyone coming together, we can achieve the outcome that we're all desperate for, and that's a safe environment.
Morning to the panel. Thanks for coming along this morning. Can I just look at these figures in a little bit more detail that the BBC are reporting last night, that of the 15,606 coaches that are coaching children, 1,298 had not been PVG checked. Are those figures accurate, Mr. Little? And you seem to imply that this was purely to do with churn amongst new coaches coming in. Is that the case of all of those 1,298 coaches? Have they applied for their PVG check? So they're in the process. It's purely just waiting for that check to be carried out.
Yeah. What I would say is that the figures are not entirely accurate. We have carried out 16,617 PVG checks. At the moment, as part of the churn, we have 949 officials that we're working through at the moment. These people are attending PVG meetings to fill in forums and submit forums in order to catch up with the process. Can I say, while we're here today, you know, representing football, this is a cross sport. I did indicate earlier on that I anticipate we'll spend £70,000 this year on a protection of our children. But I hate to think what happens in respect of some of the smaller groups. And I think
other sporting issues after this, so if we could just stick to football at the moment.
Okay.
Can I just come back to these figures then? So what you're saying is there are around 900 people waiting to be PVG checked. They have all put the applicant, or the process has begun, and you're purely waiting on those applications effectively being carried out, because when the BBC reported in December that there were 2,400 coaches and not begun the process, the Youth Football Association told the BBC there were 90 PVGs waiting to be processed, which meant that over 2,400 had simply not begun the process. So have all those people, outstanding coaches, 900 plus that you say there, they've all begun the PVG check, and all you're waiting on is effectively that process to be carried out?
Within the 949, there are a number of forums that are on their way to us. I couldn't, and I wouldn't mislead you by saying that all 949 have fully completed forums. There's meetings going on every night of the week across the length and breadth of the country. So there are forums on their way to us.
I'm just trying to get to the bottom of how much of the problem is simply waiting for the natural process, 8 weeks, to be carried out, or how much of the problem is actually starting the process, that you have coaches out there where you haven't got an application effectively for PVG checks, because you seem to have been planning in December there was a serious problem. In fact, in a statement you said you've written to all league secretaries informing them that any registered official who has participated in an 11-side programme and has not submitted a current PVG application form by the 28th of February 2017 will be placed under an automatic precautionary suspension. So you seem to be concerned in December that there was a problem with people actually submitting a PVG form. So I'm just trying to get to the bottom of how big a problem that actually is.
Well, can I say, as long as we have PVG checks outstanding, I'm concerned. Of the 949, they were all emailed, because we are halfway through that period. They were all emailed on Friday, and again, we've reiterated that statement that if they're not compliant by the 28th of February, there'll be no debate, there'll be no discussion, they will be suspended.
So there must be a problem of people actually starting the process, not just a problem waiting for that process to be completed.
The problem that we have, and we share with other similar organisations, is that this process is managed by volunteers. The volunteers, the 238 officials, are volunteers. The league officials who set the meetings up are volunteers. We're working with our volunteers to ensure a process. And like every other process, as you move on, you learn from that process. We learn what we need to do, and we implement. There are some things that I would like your good selves to consider. I think in respect of the PVG process itself, I think I would like to see an online forum, which would aid the process greatly. And again, this was something that was promised at the stakeholder group meeting in this very room when we first implemented PVGs. I think one of the other things that we need to examine, and as one of the other submissions said, the regulation's been in place for a while now. I think we need to examine, how long does a PVG check last? Is it similar to an MOT certificate, whereby on a yearly basis you need to replace it? I don't think that's practical, and I've got to be honest about that. I think we need to examine how long it's going to last for. And I think, again, I made reference to computer technology earlier on. One of the other things that we discussed at the stakeholder group was a website whereby we didn't need to go through a formal checking process again, that we would have access to a website and that would tell us.
We get that. Could I just clarify this? Are you saying that the key piece of child protection legislation and process within your organisation that has a membership of tens of thousands of young people is administered and organised and run by people who do it on the basis of goodwill and volunteering?
Exactly, yes.
Thank you. Colin.
Thanks, Mr. Committee. I'm still not clear how many of the 900 just haven't gone through the process yet and how many are actually waiting for the process to be done. But can I come to the SFA? You've obviously have a role in overseeing the Youth Football Association and their compliance. Are you satisfied with the processes that are being conducted by them to make sure that, that these coaches are properly checked?
I think the crucial thing for us is, as you know, we've set up an independent review of everything that's going on, and I think this will be one of the areas that the independent review will consider to make sure that there are no deficiencies in the system.
But by setting up that independent review, you must have serious concerns.
Well, that independent review has been set up to look at where there have been deficiencies in the past, but also to make sure that it looks at where we are now, and to see where there are deficiencies and to make recommendations where those should be closed. As I've said, we brought in the directive to give us our certain powers, which we will use. But if there's a view of the independent review that we should have, there should be less independence for the SYFA or however, then we will absolutely look at that as part of those recommendations.
But as part of your compliance, there's clearly an issue here where we have around 900 plus coaches that have not gone through PVG checks. You must be concerned about that, because it doesn't sound to me as if that's purely applications going in and simply waiting for them to be processed.
We're absolutely concerned, but as I say, it's very much Mr. Little's organisation, their responsibility to make sure that is happening.
Can I ask, Mr. McKinley, you oversee this organisation. Are you happy that the system that they operate is run via a voluntary system?
I think it's something that we need to look at, and I think it's something that
I certainly think it's something we need to look at.
I agree, and I think the independent review will look at it.
Do you think that there is sufficient investment in that system to make it work in a much slicker and quicker way?
I think that will be something that the independent review will look at, I think there's definitely, from some of the things that David has talked about, there's definitely improvements that can be made. As I've said, we have offered to provide assistance.
And what about your role in that? Where, I mean, this has not just happened. What about your oversight of that? Has there been a failure of oversight?
Well, again, I think the independent review will look at that and give
a view.
I don't believe there has. I think we were concerned about the consistency, and we brought in the directive to give us more powers, and this will give us more powers to understand much better.
The numbers that we're talking about in the BBC report, Mr. Little, is that the peak of those who have not been checked? Has there been a higher figure over time or a lower figure over time?
The figure that was quoted in December was peak.
You've never had it higher over in the history of your organisation?
No.
Okay, thank you.
No. And can I just make one final point about volunteers? Not only is our process the checks and the league setting up the meetings organised by volunteers, it's also paid for by volunteers. We don't get any government money to support that process, and we don't get any money from Sports Scotland to support that process. So there's maybe an avenue there whereby if there was finance available, we could certainly do with more people to assist.
Does Mr. McKinley's organisation give you any money?
For child protection? No.
Okay, thank you. Donald?
Yep, thank you. We've obviously spent quite rightly a lot of time on child protection, PVG checks and processes. I'd like to ask you about a range of conduct which is less serious than that, much less serious, but still important to monitor. And it goes to a question of culture and imbalance of power that Claire Hockey was asking you about. And I think it's important not just to talk about generalities here, but to try and think of an example. And one example I actually heard on the radio last week when David Beckham was being interviewed. And he spoke about his time youth training at Manchester United. And he was adamant there was no abuse. But what he did speak about, which is, I think, a helpful example, is of professionals humiliating a youth player. An example he gave was of being made to do a silly dance in front of his childhood heroes. And he said there was no wrongdoing, but it was an act of humiliation. My first question is, out of interest, do you feel 20 years on from that, that that kind of behaviour is acceptable or not? And secondly, if a child wanted to complain about something like that, how confident are you that that child would be able to do so effectively?
No, it's definitely not okay for practices like that to be in place. What we have learned through consultation with young players are the challenges around bullying behaviour, whether that's between players or whether that's in some examples of adults displaying that bullying behaviour. Again, I appreciate it's just policies and guidelines, but that is one of our policy statements is around anti-bullying. We've worked with Respect Me in putting the materials together for the guidelines, and we have a real good example in one of our member clubs of how they've went ahead and trained all staff, parents and carers and the young players around that. And it is that sense, and I agree with you, of how we get those messages very clearly to children that they are able to speak out and they are able to challenge. But that has to evolve and progress through that training.
But the question I ask is, how confident are you that a child, if a child was humiliated or bullied, how confident are you that they could effectively complain, regardless of the policies you have in place?
Of course. I'm confident in our association within our squads and within our schools that young people have that opportunity and know how to come to us to speak out. Whether that's they have confidence in their coaches that they would speak to directly, they recognise my role, they recognise the role of the Children's Rights and Wellbeing Officer. I do believe, and because I have handled concerns and because I've had players come to us and because we've taken action against coaches, I believe that confidence is there. I still think there's a road for us to go, and that's why it just so happens anti-bullying is one of the areas that are in our player education coming up. So,
can I make a comment there? To your first question, no, it's not acceptable. In fact, it's totally unacceptable. Again, in respect of recording concerns, etc., we have an incident record forum. We have a complaints management system, which are visible on the front page of our websites. We regularly send out to our 9,000-plus social media audience advising of these processes. We have a protection panel. And I think one of the things that sport needs to do, and I'm sorry, Mr. Finlay, I digress minuscule. I think sports need to get together and discuss the mechanics of how do you do this and share best practice. We've got a panel that meets every month, and that rules on membership, the disclosure checks that come back, whether a person's suitable for membership. And it also deals with allegations, you know, whereby maybe there's abuse. But can I say, and you can take this to the bank, if there is any concerns that come in, the abusing of children, we will engage the professionals, the police, to investigate that. The last point that I would make in respect of this, we have spent money and time and development, and what we're bringing forward in conjunction with the Blue Ribbon organisation in Scotland, NSPCC, is an online training programme. Now, initially, when we instituted this training, we thought there needs to be a fee for this training, but it's of so much importance, we have decided that as an organisation, we'll take the hit, and the NSPCC training will be free to all 15,000 SYFA officials.
Claire?
I'd just like to pick up on a point that you've made a couple of times, Mr. Little, about talking about sport in general as to football. You weren't here when I'd asked my question earlier on about the power imbalance, particularly in football. In fact, I would say almost uniquely in football, where we have youngsters signing contracts, where we have youngsters affiliated with certain clubs. And given that lots of children aspire to becoming footballers, both men and women, footballers, that would you acknowledge that football is actually in a very unique position in terms of child protection and in terms of that power imbalance?
Yes, I think so. For example, my son's 35 years of age. If you ask him who his teacher at school was, he can't tell you. If you ask him who his football coaches were, he will rhyme them off. Can I congratulate the Scottish Football Association in their Operation Brave, which is reducing drastically the amount of young players who will face that aspirational problem. The Operation Brave has recognised that there were too many kids in there who basically were jersey fillers, and now that number's being reduced, and that can only help young people.
Ivan. Thanks, and thanks, panel, for coming along. I just want to say at the start, I had a son and a daughter who spent years playing football when they were younger, and it's important to recognise that obviously it's volunteers that are running these clubs, and there's certainly a lot of positive role model there as well in terms of what teaches them about teamwork and cooperation. And taking responsibility, etc. So I think it's important to recognise that in the vast majority of cases that is a situation, notwithstanding, of course, the critical situation we need to deal with regard to child protection. What I just wanted to dig a wee bit into is a couple of things. First of all, round about the PVG checks and their effectiveness. Donna mentioned earlier, obviously you're doing much more than that, which is great to hear. And we've now got, I think, approaching 10 years of this process being in place. So I don't know if there is any data on this, but I'd be interested to know if there's any data around about incidents that have been reported that have occurred over that period where you can say the evidence shows that for coaches that have been through the PVG checks, there's a much, much lower incidence and it has been effective in terms of weeding out people that shouldn't be in the process, or maybe there's not enough data for that. I'd be interested to hear that. And the second data is round about the process bottleneck for processing the PVG checks. David, you mentioned you'd done 16,500 now. Is that over 1 year? Maybe just clarify that, and maybe just a wee bit more about how long that process takes. And I appreciate you've got a lot of churn and running that voluntary organisation. I fully understand that. To understand, is there a way to condense the timescale that process takes so as you get it completed more quickly? And also maybe a wee bit about the funding you mentioned down about that. Is that an issue in terms of if there was money, or if the checks were cheaper or free or whatever, would that help to speed up the process and get more people coming through? Because at the end of the day, what we want is more qualified PVG check coaches coming through and volunteering to train kids in sport. That's what we all want to have.
Okay. If you'll pardon the poor pun, PVG is only goalkeeper to the system. The most important thing here is a robust recruitment process using local knowledge, and then while we're totally satisfied, then moving into a PVG scenario. Yes, we have done all of those PVG checks. And prior to that, we had done POXA checks. We've been involved in this process from the very, very beginning. And the beauty about that longevity in the process was there was a whole stack of training delivered by Volunteer Scotland in the early days. I'm just a wee bit concerned for new organisations coming in. Obviously, they need the same level of support that we were lucky enough to get. In respect to...
Very brief bit of time left, so you need to be really sharp with your answers.
Yeah. In respect of funding, funding's an issue. I believe that if we look at other forms of PVG checking, electronic forms, etc., that can assist. But any funding from Scottish Government to allow us to beef up our process would be most welcome.
And just to clarify, that 16,500, is that what you've processed in a single year, or
no? That's over the period of the process.
Right. Okay.
The big difficulty we had was the restriction on the number of checks. And again, when you've got
so who placed that restriction?
It was Disclosure Scotland at the beginning.
And is that's gone now?
It's now gone.
Right.
Hence the reason that, you know, we're up to 800 checks per month at the moment.
Okay, thank you. And just on that point, is there any data that anyone's got that says if you've been through the checks, you're safer, if you like, in those terms?
Well, I'll answer you on the basis of the last two people that we terminated their membership had been through the process and had been fully accepted into membership. And their disclosure was completely blank in respect to criminal records.
Okay.
I would say that definitely the process is working, where obviously we have all our individuals who are in regulated work PVG scheme members. We have been notified when people are being considered for listing, and that's allowed us to place precautionary suspensions while that listing has been looked at. So in terms of reducing the risk, definitely the function of PVG is playing a role there. But I guess what I believe that we need to inform and support, not just within football but within wider sport, is that second responsibility of referring individuals. So if David's mentioning that he is taking people out of regulated work roles, it's then our responsibility to make that referral to prevent them from working anywhere else with children.
Okay.
The referrals are currently in process.
Thank you.
A couple of final things in relation to agents and scouts and intermediaries. Is there an issue there? Are they a loophole, if you like? Do those people need covered?
A matter that specifically has been raised by the NSPCC in their evidence. I think there could be a loophole in the legislation there. It looks like there is a loophole in the legislation. I think it's something that the legislation should look at.
Okay. You said earlier that football mirrors society. At the highest level, I don't think it mirrors society at all, because football at that level is often very irrational. It draws people's ambitions and overwhelming emotions and loyalty from people who are fans, and not necessarily just young people. Older people act very irrational around football at times. And people would, you know, walk over broken glass to play for their club, stand on the pitch, never mind getting paid for it. So for young people, that, you know, the potential for young people to play for those top clubs draws often, you know, overwhelming emotion and drive, not just from them but from their families as well. Given the vested interests in football, given the huge amount of money at the top level, is there a willingness by the top clubs to confront this and be completely open and deal with all elements of this? Or are there those vested interests that might cause them not to be acting in a fully open manner? Maybe Mr. Wishart would be the best person to comment.
This being the issue of child protection and sport?
Yes, the whole issue around, you know, the topic and historic issues and current issues.
Well, I think in previous years, I think there's quite often there's a reluctance to deal with issues from the top clubs. But I think now, given the remit of the Scottish FA's review, and given the person that's been in charge of it, who we've experienced and who's a good knowledge of that area, I think clubs have to be open and transparent in terms of the review to get to the bottom of it. We've spoken a lot about the power imbalance, which I agree with, and I think that's an issue that clubs need to address and perhaps be part of the review, where a player, young lads, signs a registration form at, say, age 11, and the club can unilaterally renew that every year, and there's a compensation payment upon that. That in itself deals an imbalance. I think we have to, it's been touched upon by some of the members here, a better reporting system and a safer reporting system where somebody is happier to come forward. I don't believe that in 3,000 Club Academy Scotland players there's not one issue that's been raised. The wellbeing panel hasn't heard any yet, but I'm aware of a number of issues that have been raised. But there is the issue around compensation when somebody's not happy moving one club to another. So I think clubs have to address that. I think we have to address the issue of intermediaries where unregulated people and unchecked people are able to go and sign representation contracts with minors, with 13, 14, whatever age. I think that's something that needs to be looked at, similar to the English system where you do register and you have to go through a check if you want to go with minors. But I think now, given the huge focus that's on this, I think that the clubs have to be open, they have to be transparent. We have to get to the bottom of this, because if we don't get a proper report as to what went on previously and who said what to whom and why were issues raised with clubs and not dealt with by the clubs, which has been raised with me personally, then I think that the review will fail, and people who have survived abuse will come forward and say, no, that's not good enough. I think there's a lot of issues around the professional game. That's my area of knowledge. The one point I'd make about the, and it's been said today about the SYFA and the youths, it's absolutely reliant on volunteers. And the vast, vast, vast majority of people who volunteer in football and sport do so just out of goodwill. And I think we have to support these people. There are, I think, issues around, I think David can maybe clarify this, but certain levels of coaching qualifications you need to have. You also have to go through first aid qualifications as well, and the PVG check, all of which I think should be in place. But I think we've talked about barriers. I think the first question was as well. Let's not put barriers in there. I think we have to inform people. I didn't know this until this morning, until Donna told me, that volunteers can go through a PVG check and it's free of charge. But there's a commitment there financially in terms of the qualifications. There's a commitment there in terms of time as well. And I think we have to support the people who are monitoring this, and we have to support the individuals themselves who have to go through this process, because we do not want to discourage the people who put in so much time and so much effort to coach my children when they went through various sports as well, because if we don't have them, then our children don't have sports to play. So I think that's an area as well we have to really look at, is it support in terms of finance, of time or whatever else, because these people are vital to the well-being of our children.
Do you want a final point, Mr McKinley?
Nothing particularly to add.
Thank you very much for your attendance this afternoon. Really appreciate it. I think all of us, I think the final point that was made, I think all of us would concur with that what we want to do is have the best system possible that protects children and young people, but also coaches and volunteers who give up their time every week to help young people in Scotland. So it's in all our interest to get this right. We look forward with interest to the review coming up. Thank you very much. And can I suspend briefly for a change of panel?
Okay. This next session is a round table on child protection in sport. We'll go round the table and introduce ourselves. So my name is Neil Finlay. I'm the convener of the Health and Sport Committee.
I'm Kim Atkinson. I'm Chief Executive of the Scottish Sports Association.
I'm Claire Hawkey, the MSP for Rutherglen and Deputy Convener of the Health and Sport Committee.
Tom Arthur, MSP for Renfrewshire South.
I'm George Thompson, Chief Executive of Volunteer Scotland.
Miles Briggs, MSP for Lothian Region.
John Lunn, Head of Pathways at Sport Scotland.
I'm Alex Cole-Hamilton, I'm MSP for Edinburgh Western, I'm Lib Dem Health Spokesperson.
Tam Bailey, I'm the Children and Young People's Commissioner for Scotland.
Donald Cameron, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Mary Glasgow, Director of Children's Services at Children First.
Alison Johnston, MSP for Lothian.
Forbes Dunlop, CEO of Scottish Swimming.
Richard Lyle, MSP for Uddingston and Belsong.
John Hawkins, ACC, Police Scotland.
Marie Todd, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Matt Ford, National Head for NSPCC Scotland.
I'm Colin Smith, MSP for the South of Scotland.
I'm Lauren Bruce, the Policy Manager at COSLA.
Ivan McKee, MSP for Glasgow Proven.
Thank you, and the rest of the people at the table are committee clerks. The Parliament photographer will be taking photographs as we go through the meeting. And could I also say that before moving to questions, can I remind members and witnesses that for the purposes of the standing order rule and sub judice, no mention should be made of any to any live ongoing cases during this evidence session or to any issues which might prejudice those cases. Alison, would you like to begin?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and I have a couple of questions, and I'd like to direct them in particular, if I may, to Mr. Ford from the NSPCC. I'm not sure if you were listening to our previous evidence session this morning, Mr. Ford. I think it sort of shines a light on one of your suggestions, certainly, because clearly serious concerns have been raised this morning. You suggest that Parliament undertakes post-legislative scrutiny to ascertain how the system is operating in practice. I wonder why you came to that view.
I think in the period, first of all, can I say thank you, and we welcome the opportunity to give evidence today to the Health and Sport Committee. And, you know, we've been very concerned by the allegations which have come to light across the UK about sexual abuse in football. While we do believe that progress has been made in putting in place child protection processes, first of all, we think that's only a step on the way, because the most important goal is to build a culture in football and across sport that has children's wellbeing truly at its heart. And that in such a culture, everyone is fully aware of the responsibilities they have to children, to keep children safe. We believe that all children have a right to be safe when they participate in sport. And we've heard in the earlier session much about the excellent work that volunteers in particular do, but coaches in general do for our young people, that helps make them healthier, more confident, and so on. And most of the allegations that we're aware of date back to a period before the PVG scheme was in operation. So there's room to believe that we've come some way from those days in having processes in place to ensure that individuals who pose a risk are identified and banned from working with them in sports or other settings. But having said that, we believe there's no room for complacency. Good policies need strong and consistent application. Compliance is important across organisations and across responsible bodies. And it's right that when we have the opportunity that's afforded by the realities that are revealed by the allegations that have come forward, that we take time to reflect on what might be done now better to protect
and support our children in sports settings. The PVG scheme, again, there's been discussion already in front of the committee about, it's 10 years since the PVG scheme was approved, and it fully came into force. It's been fully in force following the catch-up period for at least 5 years. It would appear to us the right time to look at how it's operating in practice. I believe today we've already heard of some practical realities that need to be thought about, and it certainly would be appropriate for some proper scrutiny to be applied at this stage.
Mm-hmm. I think your comments are very well made. It does seem that, you know, if we're relying on a small number of full-time staff and thousands of volunteers to deal with a very large administrative workload, that it would be well worth having a look at. One of the other areas that your evidence, your written submission touches on is the Abuse of Trust Sexual Offences Act 2009, and you point out really that coaches aren't covered by the definition of position of trust as a teacher would be. I think I was quite surprised when I read that, possibly an area that we haven't given a lot of attention or focus to. How do you think that covering coaches with that definition would help?
I think the consideration that I think is worthwhile here, in the spirit of reflecting on how are we doing everything we can to protect children, is to look at current legislation that's intended to identify areas where children can be vulnerable. And the position of trust legislation addressed something that we have seen as a problem, where children can be exploited by people who are in a position of power over them, in a position of trust, but perhaps at that time believing that they're in a consensual adult relationship. Now, that sort of definition, it seems to me, works very clearly applies to the sorts of situations that have already been discussed in front of the committee this morning, the sorts of situations where a child or a young person is desperate to succeed at their sport. We're talking about football, we've been talking about football being the highest profile sport, the highest status sport in Scotland. It touches to the aspirations, indeed the kind of identities of many young people and their families. So coaches and others involved in the life of the young football player are people of enormous influence and power, and there is an imbalance that is in place there, and there is without doubt a position of trust that is occupied by coaches, and in those situations we have to make sure that the law is clear that abuse of those positions of trust should not be allowed. So we think that it's worth reviewing that legislation to see where coaches and other people, we identify also in our written submission, we identify talent scouts, for example, who may well be people. I mean, the young person would be very eager to please. You can see why. So that's a position of trust.
I think these are all areas that could be looked at in any post-legislative scrutiny. Can I ask one final question, Convener?
Could we have brief questions and answers, because we ain't got a lot of time this morning?
Very briefly, what impact have the allegations had on the work of the NSPCC on a day-to-day basis?
The main impact has been through our national helpline, which we set up a dedicated line for survivors to call, and so there has been a steady flow. We had to we had to make some very quick changes to expand our capacity to take those calls, and then of course there's a huge job of making sure that they're appropriately dealt with and passed on to the police, and arrangements are in place for that. I'm glad to say that we've been able to cope with that demand, but it's been an unprecedented demand around one particular area of children's life, i.e. sport. So we haven't had that particular focus on sport or football before, but it's the sort of activity that the NSPCC helpline is able to respond to.
Thank you.
Alex, and just to the other members of the panel, please indicate if you want to come in on any of the points that's been raised. Okay.
Thank you, Convener. Looking at the BBC report today about the number of coaches in various sports in Scotland who are checked and those who are not, it seems that some disciplines of sport are getting it right, boxing, gymnastics, athletics, tennis, golf, hockey, where some are consistently wide of the mark. One in particular concerns me is swimming, which seems to have as much as 10% of coaches unchecked. Particularly, I raise that because I think swimming is unique in the sense that in terms of the regulated childcare position, in terms of unsupervised contact, given the nature of swimming, the changing rooms, showers, the likelihood of nudity and things like that, that this is a bigger problem for me. Perhaps I'd like Forbes to address that in particular, but then open up to the wider panel as to why some sports are getting this right and others are not, and how we can disseminate best practice across the piece. But Mr. Dunlop.
Thank you. Our processes in place require all coaches to be checked. The numbers who are not checked are down to a lag or a delay in that checking process. I have absolute confidence that all those that we state being unchecked will be checked. I also have confidence that none of those people are working individually with swimmers. They are poolside helpers working with coaches who are qualified and PVG checked. So if I can give an example, a parent wanting to help out on poolside, we'll start that and the system will then catch up and help them become a qualified coach, but also put them through a PVG check. Clearly, the spotlight that's been put in this area just now makes us reflect on whether people should be allowed on poolside in any capacity before they're checked, and that's something we'll need to go away and consider. I would, however, like to also stress that the PVG component of the child protection system is one. We also are very proactive. All our member clubs have a volunteer child protection officer. They're all trained. It's all free of charge. We train around 500 members a year in the In Safe Hands courses run by Children First. They're also free of charge. And the one other change from the football evidence, we have a layer of professional staff, if you like, who are there to support and help these volunteers at clubs. So we have five regional officers across Scotland who deal with and support simple cases of child protection. And then myself and a part-time welfare officer who are on call 24/7 to support and deal with more serious cases. So we've reflected on our figures. We'll look at that. We'll consider what we do about that. But I would give assurance that these people are not working individually with children. They're working under a qualified and checked coach.
So if I may convene, if I can open up to the panel as to the disparity between, you know, the example, and I absolutely accept the explanation that you've given, but does that mean then that some sports have a zero tolerance approach to not allowing coaches on the ground if they haven't had their PVG checked, whereas some don't operate that? I don't know who wants to go first.
MD. Have any knowledge of that?
Speaking to my colleagues, that is the case, yes. Some some sports will say there is zero tolerance. You cannot help out at this club until you have a PVG check in place.
Just to say thanks very much for the opportunity to come along today to this session. And probably just to reiterate Forbes' points there, that there is, I would say, consistency in terms of application across governing bodies in terms of the processes, procedures and systems that are in place. And we, although the figures have come via ourselves in terms of the release, it's important to contextualise that in far more detail than perhaps the BBC or the media would, which is that there are a number of coaches will be classed as working with children who would not be in what would be defined as a regulated working position and therefore are not required to be checked. In some sports, they'll check all those coaches anyway, but the regulations do not require that to be the case. In other cases, as Forbes has said, there is a lag. We have a lot of governing bodies run coach education towards the end of the year. Those coaches are, at that point, identified as working with children, and then the PVG process is commenced at that point. So there are gaps, and we've gone through this with each individual sport, and we have no concerns that there's anything like the gap we've seen in the Scottish Youth Football Association in any of the other sports. So that's probably the first point to make in that respect. And the other point is that the PVG checking itself is just one component of what is a robust system. You know, there are a number of other aspects of this around child protection officers and clubs, which is where the responsibility lies in the legislation for the checking itself. That network gets extensive training. You know, we work with children first, as Forbes indicated, in providing that training. There's been more than 23,000 officials put through that training since that training programme started. So that's just one aspect of it. We do bring those groups together and share best practice. There's updates on what the legislation is. You know, there is a robust comprehensive system around there, and to look at the PVG piece and the gaps that are there in isolation is perhaps just looking at one aspect.
So in terms of what Scotland's view of the Youth Football Association, what is your view as to why there's such a problem there?
Again, I mean, that's been documented and discussed at the earlier session extensively.
Yeah, but that was their view. It's your view I'm looking for.
The Youth Football Association is one of the member bodies of the Scottish FA, and that really is for them to work through that in more detail, and it should be more robust than it is. And they've
no, but what's Sports Scotland's view as to why there's such a problem?
I think the problem has been that just they've identified some of the scale of some of what they're trying to do.
So is it scale and resources?
In some respects, I think there's scale and resource, but it is part of a wider system that is in place, and it is there, and that is robust. And we're not saying that system is perfect. There's always opportunities to improve on that, and some of what's been discussed today at the earlier session has identified where some of those improvements could be made.
Anybody else want to come in? Donald?
Can I just ask you a rather basic question, but in a standard case where there's no further assessment in terms of PVG checking, how long does it take?
I think that would be a question I would ask Disclosure Scotland for. I mean, I'm not aware of it. I know it's variable, but they would understand exactly what the time frame is like for a processing case to take place.
Okay. Yeah.
There's no backlog in the overall system just now. It will depend a little bit on whether or not there is actually a criminal record that comes up, so that can affect it. But in terms of our handling it, at the Disclosure Services side, it literally is in a matter of days that we turn things around. So there's no lag in the overall system. But I would say, though, it might sound a bit ironic in the sense that we put through approximately 50,000 PVGs a year. And as such, I think when we look at some of the issues that Scottish Youth Football Association have and others, it's not something that's causing us great concern. It's not in the nature that the media is covering in some of the questions today. Yes, clearly it's been covered in the evidence to you that there are problems about some of the communications and the reach to out, you know, small groups and everything else, about making that a bit tighter, for sure. But if your question, convener, was not so much why are there these delays, but is there a risk to children that these delays are bringing about, then that's a different thing. You know, coaches that are coming through that are in the system, that are going, that know that they're going to be filling in the forms, that are going through PVG and the other checks, are, to my mind, not the most likely individuals to come in with a harm in their intent. And I think that overall, what I'd like to say is that we're the systemic failures of 20 and 30 years ago, which of course includes the BBC, and how they systematically failed to look after the welfare of children in their care, is not the system just now. I think we've got a balanced and proportionate and intelligent system that's trying its best to actually look at where the risks are, to manage those risks, and to make it a system which is attractive for everybody to feel safe in. And I think it did come out a little bit with the earlier and quite evidence. I think you have to consider as a group the importance of creating a safe environment for volunteers as well. And I know Tam Bailey, the Children Commissioner, will be saying things shortly, I'm sure, but I remember Kathleen Marshall doing some research into this some 10 years ago when she was the Children's Commissioner. And she discovered that when she was looking at the issue about men not volunteering with children across all different fronts, why was that? And for those men that were not involved with children, it was the fear of accusation was one of the main breaks for them not coming in to be a volunteer. For those men that were involved, as volunteers with children, they didn't have the same fear. So we've got to create an environment whereby everybody feels safe and confident that you can volunteer, contribute to children's welfare, children's sport and development, in the knowledge that we are managing the risk of those that are there that would do harm. But don't, if you like, throw the baby out with the bathwater.
Colin.
A point that Mr. Lund raised, rightly pointing out the fact that obviously PVG is only part of the process, and I just want to touch on the minimum operating requirements that you've obviously highlighted in your evidence. And I'm just keen to know who actually assesses whether those requirements are actually being met, and how is that assessment conducted? Obviously, you have sanctions, if you like, that you can use if those requirements are not being met. Have those sanctions ever been used? And what do you do when you've had to use those sanctions to make sure that the children in those organisations are being fully protected if the minimum requirements are not actually being implemented? And the final point is just, it's obviously very difficult to get to, in the back of Mr. Thompson's point, it was clear this morning, it's very difficult to get to the bottom of the figures as to how many of those outstanding PVGs are actually simply because we're waiting for the 8 or 10 weeks process to be conducted, or actually no application has gone in. And I think it's very difficult to get to the bottom of that based on this morning's evidence. But I'm just keen to know if people think there's a wider issue. Is it a slow process for somebody to be PVG checked, or is there a wider problem there?
Okay, a number of points there. I think the starting point with the minimum operating requirements is we have a partnership with Children First. The MORs were developed by them and they assess that. So that's been a long-standing relationship we've had. That's now done on a quarterly basis. So they'll give us an assessment of the components of those MORs, of which there's 8, and give us a status in terms of where that sport is. That's formally reported on a quarterly basis, and we've got that trend information over time. The MORs is probably helpful to understand is the starting point that we're working with. We're currently working on revised standards for those, which take that further and start to include some of the areas that were raised earlier around bullying and putting the rights of the child at the centre of it. So the MORs are very much the starting point for that. In terms of sanctions, we get reports from Children First on the status of the MORs with each governing body, as I said, quarterly, and we can and do operate a number of processes around that. Our objective is to get those governing bodies as compliant as quickly as possible, because ultimately, applying a heavy sanction, perhaps withdrawal of funding, could have an impact negatively on the children involved and on the clubs on the ground. So we do have a number of support mechanisms in place there to support those organisations to get them back to compliance. We can put conditions on their investment that requires them to achieve that more quickly. We can work with them, and Children First work collaboratively with those partners that have found that they're not compliant at that particular point in time.
Come back on the funding. Obviously, you indicated that you fund Children's First. I think it's £125,000 per annum. I think it's clear that the training that people get through that is obviously incredibly welcome. One of the points raised this morning, though, from the Youth Football Association was the fact that they don't get any funding for the significant cost around, for example, PVGs. Do you provide any funding to any governing body to meet those substantial costs?
Yes, it's slightly more complicated than that. We invest in governing bodies. We invest in 52 of those. A number of those receive what we call effective organisation investment. That totals over £3 million a year. That underpins robust organisations. So that doesn't just cover their safeguarding duties. It would cover things like anti-doping and legal compliance that they have as well. And how those governing bodies choose to deploy that resource It's not entirely up to them, but we would work with them to understand where that the resource can have that best impact. So that's the direct piece to the governing bodies. How that then filters down into the individual components of work, we expect some of that to go into this area, because that's a compliance piece that we expect the governing bodies to meet. So that's part of it.
Okay. Clear.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to take us back a little bit to the panel before and ask a question really of the Children's Commissioner, if that's possible. You would have heard that I'd asked about your report where you had talked in May 2015 about a power imbalance in football. And I see from your written report, and I'm going to quote from what you've submitted to committee today, that despite some improvements, my view is that there has not been the necessary attitudinal change to give confidence that the circumstances where some adults seek to exploit children are eradicated from football. I wonder if you could expand on that, please, and tell us what you think should be done so that it does give you that reassurance.
Okay, and thanks for the invite today. Before I do, I just need to correct something that you said earlier, which was children being asked to leave clubs. That was in reference to other sporting clubs, football clubs, just so there's clarity. I came into this many years ago, really at the behest of the Petitions Committee, on quite a straightforward matter, which was children being held to contracts by professional football clubs as to whether they could play for their school team or not. And the committee was asking a fairly simple question: is this an infringement on their rights? And to me it was straightforward, and it's dragged on and on and on. And in the meantime, a number of other issues have come to light, which are being dealt with through the Petitions Committee. But that single issue of whether children can play for their school team or not didn't get resolved until last year, when the SFA changed their rules so that children would have an unqualified right to play for their school team. So my comments today really are coloured by that process and how long it's taken for us to achieve very small change. And in the meantime, there are other outstanding matters which, in my view, the football clubs, the professional football clubs, have remained intransigent. And that's why I say that the situation of the kind of power imbalance between children and the football clubs remains, because it's in the vested interests of the clubs to have complete control of those children. And that's evidenced by the way that they have held out on certain contractual matters, the way that they operate the compensation scheme. It's all to the advantage of the professional football clubs and to the disadvantage, in my view, of the children involved. Now, that power imbalance is actually really about the culture within the football clubs, within the professional football clubs. And it's been mentioned several times today about this business of the culture and how we value our children and young people. Despite some of the efforts that the SFA have put into place, despite the SFA appointing various officers and having procedures and sending directives, the overall culture remains that the professional football clubs have control of those children and young people who are under their charge. And that's what concerns me. And that's where I don't see much change within our professional game.
Do you see that mirrored in other sports?
I don't. I think in my evidence I said I don't really have the same in-depth knowledge of the other sports, so it's difficult to comment. But the ingredients of the coaches having power over those children and young people, and in fact having in the palms of their hands the access to their dreams. I mean, these are children who are desperate to be as good as they can possibly be, possibly seek a living from the sport that they love and enjoy. And we've got thousands of people who want to assist them in doing that. And that's why there's an extra onus on the clubs, and particularly the professional football clubs, that they are extra diligent to make sure that they respect the children and young people, and that they in fact treat them in a way which they would want to be treated themselves, and not being held, to my mind, unfairly in terms of some of the contractual arrangements that they have within the clubs. Now, this, as I said, this is actually for the Petitions Committee, which I'm appearing at later this week to try and decide what's the best way forward here. My view is that it needs external regulation. I don't think that the governing structures within Scottish football allow for the self-regulation that is required. And just on the issue of PVG, PVG is only as good as the information that is put into it. So we shouldn't be reliant on just PVG, and it's been said by several other contributors. It's about procedures, it's about monitoring, but overall, it's about the culture that you have within that sport. And that's where my concerns come from football. And a further point that's come to light is the issue of agents. Agents who are acting on behalf of children. Because where there's money, then there will be agents who will try and make some money for themselves. A year ago, I wrote to the SFA expressing concerns, SFA and SPFL, about the child protection checking on those people who act as agents, and they took no action. Now, thankfully, as a result of appearances in December, Andrew has given an indication that that will form part of the review. But it gives you, for me, it's an indication of the slow response of the football clubs to the responsibility that they have to the children in their charge.
Marie, and I'm keen that other people come in on any of the issues that we're discussing, so please indicate it. Marie.
Thank you. I was particularly interested in what you said there, John Lennon, and I understand the limitations of the PVG check, but I do. I mean, as a parent, I think it's a bare minimum that I would expect anyone involved in a club and working with my children to have been PVG checked. And I wonder if one of the issues is that there is a misunderstanding or a lack of clarity around who needs to be PVG checked. I was interested in what you said about it's okay if they're not PVG checked so long as they're supervised by a coach. And my understanding was that actually anyone who is involved in teaching and coaching sessions ought to be PVG checked. I thought the type of people who were exempted from being PVG checked might be, for example, accountants who act as treasurers for the club, rather than those who are directly at it working with children, whether supervised or not. I wonder if you could give me some clarity around that. I presume there was a zero tolerance then.
I'm happy to start that one off, but there's others are probably better placed to answer the detail. But it comes around the definition of what's regulated work, and that's where the child protection officers in the clubs assess that, and they're responsible for raising the necessary paperwork, rightly so, because they're the ones on the ground seeing who comes into their clubs, what they're doing, what that looks like. And as earlier colleagues mentioned at the earlier evidence session, recruitment processes are key to that. But the PVG system as it is only allows for checks to be carried out on those doing regulated work as it's defined, and there is a tool where they can assess that and see if the activity is actually regulated. So that does account for some of the gaps where individuals are classed as working with children, but it's not classed as a regulated activity as such.
Just on that point, Amina. just also to say that this is further confused by the fact that it is an offence to request a PVG for someone who's not in a regulated child care position. So you've got providers or service providers or sports agencies, whoever, got to sort of thread that needle. In terms of my understanding from the work I did on the voluntary issues, you know, the implementation group, was that in terms of supervision, it's the regulated element comes into play if they do not normally, and of course, and the word is normally, have unsupervised contact with children, and no reasonable expectation would be that they have unsupervised contact with children. That's why you can have situations like poolside help and swimming clubs who are never going to be left in an unsupervised capacity. If that can be guaranteed, then they don't require that PVG check at that time.
Yes.
Can I just clarify, though, that firstly, we do define regulated roles, and it goes beyond coaches. We have a number of regulated roles that need to be checked. And also clarify that the examples I've given are people that should be and will be checked. We don't have a policy of you don't have to be checked. We are probably err on the side of caution, and we would check them. The only delay and lag, and it isn't with Disclosure Scotland, it's with the volunteers in the clubs, getting the individual, sitting down with them, completing the form, getting the evidence, getting the people to sign off the forms and submitting it. Once it's submitted, it's a very smooth process, I must say.
Yeah.
I think it's back to a balanced and proportionate system again.
when you go back some years before PVG, it was a bit unbalanced. You know, it was contact with children, and it became too much a blanket affair. So now I think, whilst there is a review that the Deputy First Minister has announced last year of PVG, and that's underway, Disclosure Scotland is leading on that process. That does give an opportunity to take into consideration some of these points about other types of roles and are they covered. But I think we need to take real care about avoiding a situation where we start to go into contact with children requires people to have to go through the checking process. And Alex is absolutely right. And in my experience in the 15 years we've operated it, it's been more the case that the problems that have arisen has been about the misuse of actually asking for information that was not entitled based on the role, rather than people that are proven to have been a threat after having gone through the system. And it's also a detail perhaps to share with you that it's not a crime not to put through even a regulated role through the system. It's a crime if you actually have one of the 3,500 people that are on the barred list that's gone through that. So that will also be something that's under consideration in the review. But you're absolutely right, that causes confusion and uncertainty amongst people about should everybody be covered or just a few and what. So we do struggle, and our role is to provide support on compliance and training and everything else, and we do that. We're doing that all the time, but because of what we said earlier about the churn effect and people coming in and carrying their assumptions, not least from the media coverage, then that creates further confusion and uncertainty.
Can I further ask, another potential barrier might be, as some of the evidence suggested earlier, the cost of going through the process. Did I pick up correctly that there's a difference that volunteers can be PVG checked without incurring a cost?
Right, I can answer that quickly. And it's just that we are set up by government to enable those that have come through the charitable sector, the third sector. Volunteers in there are entitled to free checks through the disclosure services process. So it's not a cover for all volunteers. So you'll have coaches in local authorities, for instance, and they are not afforded free checks, and they have to fit into the paid basis through the local authority. And there are examples where the volunteers are being asked to pay for their own checks in those circumstances, which is another matter. But if you've come through a charity and through Swimming Scotland and everything else, then you're covered for a free check.
John.
Thanks, Convener. I wanted to offer broader observations, if that's okay, from a policing point of view, and I'm really grateful for the opportunity to do that today. I think it's really important to recognise that sport is a real force for good in our communities today. I would hate for any of these discussions to lead to a position in which somehow sport is demonised. Clearly, that can't happen. I also wanted to acknowledge that clearly there have been huge improvements over the years, whether it's the child protection arrangements or whether it's the PVG scheme. But in truth, the question that really bothers me is, could this happen again in another sport? Could the situation that we've seen in football happen again? And sadly, I believe it could. And I think we need to consider that and really think carefully about that. And I say that for a couple of reasons. I think, firstly, we've got to accept that there's a risk in society today. We've seen on many occasions those who would wish to sexually abuse children finding a way to do so, finding a way to navigate their way around the systems and the processes that are put in place in order that they can infiltrate any social setting in which children gather, whether that is a sports club, whether it's a youth club, or whether it's an online setting. So that risk exists. And then I think we need to ask ourselves, secondly, does the environment that allowed the abuse to occur in football, does it still prevail in society today? And again, sadly, I think it does, and we need to accept that. So there's a number of things I think we need to do. Clearly, there's a need to review PVG compliance. I think that's been really compelling in the discussions this morning. It seems to me that governing bodies, that individual sports clubs need to urgently review the steps that they've got in place. There may be a cause for some
post-legislative review as well. Perhaps that's a good idea. But it seems to me we would be slightly naive if we were to think that that is some kind of silver bullet, that will stop child sexual abuse in Scotland. I don't think that is the case. What we do need, therefore, is a wider discussion about the culture that in society that allows that to exist. And it seems to me it's a culture in which we are appalled and really disappointed, infuriated when we see reports of child sexual abuse in the media. But the truth is we don't like to think about it or to talk about it when that's not the case. My fear is that that builds a kind of wall of silence. It's a wall of silence behind which survivors are often stigmatised. Child abuse isn't reported, and those who would abuse children can prevail. So we need to open the discussion beyond football, beyond sport, I think, but sport is critical, given it is that force for good. And it seems to me that perhaps one of the things we need to do is to really talk about a long-term preventative strategy in Scotland, a strategy that can allow us all to think about individuals, to think about communities, and in particular to think about a sustained educational effort, because we need to get to a position in which we can talk openly about this.
Thank you. Anybody else want to come in on those points? No? Yeah, Mark?
Yeah, I just want to say I wholeheartedly agree with those comments. And I think it is important to say the measures that we've advocated in our evidence today, we would not see them as a panacea. They are steps that we possibly could make some improvements. But that question about changing the culture of sport is a wider question about changing our culture as a society. In that sense, football is a mirror to society, because children have been abused in football. And while the allegations that we know about are historic, child sexual abuse is not. Child sexual abuse is happening today. There are children in our school classrooms who are experiencing child sexual abuse. And I believe that we should see that as unacceptable, and we should speak about it, and there should be openness that this is happening, and it's happening to far too many children. And that's the context of child sexual abuse in sport. And no child, we should be clear, no child should have to experience such abuse and the harm that it does, and the harm that can last a whole lifetime. And, we need to think seriously about what more we can do to prevent child sexual abuse and the way that we tolerate it in our society.
Richard. Sorry, you want to come in briefly, George, before Richard, just very briefly.
It was just really maybe a more general point than that. I don't think you can create that without a positive visualisation of children in the first place. And as such, I think that there's a danger psychologically if what you focus in on is vulnerability, that you actually unintendedly accentuate that. What we've got to have is a vision whereby we've got a participative society where a lot of adults are working with children professionally and voluntarily in safe and constructive fashions, where the positive image of that is the thing that's at our forefront, where there's a need to manage the risk and of course to do everything possible to avoid those that suffer. But I think the way to do that is to create the bigger picture, a positive picture, rather than over focus on the negative.
Okay. Richard.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Yes, and I have to agree with you. There are a lot of people who are involved running clubs, girls' brigade, boys' brigade, a lot of people who do a lot of good work, and basically, we have to concentrate on the problems, not the, make it out to be worse than what it is. But can I turn to Mr. Bailey again? I know you answered part of my question to Claire Hoggie, but basically in your report you're saying that you've been involved in the Public Petitions Committee, PE1319, Improving Youth Football, since March 2010.
Yeah.
You've presented Press for Changes, and there have been positive movement from SFA and SPFL. However, there have been outstanding matters which the football authorities have, you've already said, disproven and transients, which led you to an overall assessment summed up in your most recent correspondence to the committee. You're basically saying you give credit to the SFA and the SPLA, but, SPLF, but you then go on and say external regulation has to be imposed on bodies which, to my mind, are either unwilling or incapable of taking appropriate action to safeguard the rights of children. Would you like to expand on that?
Yeah, that's a change of position, actually, because my first position when I presented to the Petitions Committee was that it's always best to have self-regulation. And that's, in fact, what I was recommending to the committee at that time. But since then, there's matters where the SFA and the SPFL have refused to make any movement, even having reviewed it. It becomes quite technical, but it's about the contracts that children are held to at age 15 through 16 and 17. Fraser mentioned earlier the compensation scheme that operates within Scottish football, and in the most recent evidence that Andrew McKinley and Neil Doncaster gave to the committee, it was repeated several times that, in their view, the balance between the interests of the clubs and the interests of the children was striking the right balance. And in my view, it just isn't, because all of the control of the children in terms of their access or their behaviour whilst they're signed with those clubs is within the club. And the only bit that really there's been positive movement on is this business of youth football and the creation of the posts within SFA. So I applaud the guidance, I applaud the procedures that they put in place. But the culture is still that the clubs are in control of those children. And they're not in any way minded to shift on that. In fact, when asked directly by the Petitions Committee, Neil Doncaster said they have got no intention of changing that balance, because in their view, it would disincentivise the clubs to invest in youth football. And it comes down to the investment is in terms of how those clubs see those children. They see them as a potential investment, and therefore they want to try and reap some of the rewards of that. And I'm afraid I don't normally talk in these terms at committee, but it has been a really torturous process even to get to this stage just now. I've changed my position from self-regulation to one of external regulation.
I respect your view, Mr. Bailey, and I actually want to encourage your perception of what government or committee or the SFA or whatever. You know, there are a lot of, you know, the point I made earlier, there are a lot of good people out there who are working with kids day in, day out, and some of them actually feel as though they're being targeted. My wife and my daughter run a girls' brigade, and they've been checked, and a lot of good people out there. And basically, what we've got to do, we've got to concentrate on the situation. But I also agree with the point that Mr. Matt Ford made, that, you know, there is abuse, with children outside, you know, this. So we've got to look at the whole. So what would you, as a commissioner, what would you advocate? You now have, you know, the floor to tell us what you would advocate in order to bring additional regulation or circumstances into this to try and eradicate it.
Okay, I'm jumping to my evidence on Thursday. But I agree, first of all, I have to agree with the statements or the comments and observations with regard to the societal view of children and young people and the value that we place in them. And of course, nobody here would disagree that we have to actually change and improve on the value of that we place on children and young people. But specifically with regard to football, I think that it does need external regulation. And in fact, it's not just in Scotland, because there's currently a House of Commons committee is looking at the state of the English FA, and there are very similar forces at play. And some of the conclusions on that is that they are pressing the government to take some action in terms of how they would externally regulate the behaviour of the football clubs. So I'll certainly be recommending that on Thursday. The engagement of the government with this particular issue may take various forms. That hasn't been agreed in any shape or form, because essentially the government will, I expect, give evidence to the committee. But in my view, the current governance structures do not allow for the kind of change which I have been trying to press for, and which I think is needed to ensure that children and young people do experience that cultural change of being better valued within the professional football clubs. And please be clear, I'm talking about professional football clubs here, because obviously there's matters which are much wider than this, and other people have already commented on that. Yes, we do need societal change, but there are things that the professional football clubs as leaders could actually do.
You're an appointee of the government?
No, I'm not. I'm an appointee of Parliament. So I'm independent of government.
So you're independent of government. I just wanted to clarify that.
Mary, yeah.
Thank you.
Not so much on that point, but just on the broader points, I welcomed both the comments from Matt and also from ACC Hawkins about the fact that abuse of children is much broader than in sport. And in fact, from our own experience and from evidence, most children are actually abused within intimate family relationships and in their own homes. So in some ways, sport is a reflection of a wider societal problem. I mean, we certainly see through our work with Sport Scotland in safeguarding and sport that there has been much progress made over the last 15 years. The allegations that were made are historic, and whilst we're not complacent about the fact that they could happen again, of course they could, I think there's much better awareness of the responsibility on adults to know what to do when and if they suspect that a child is at risk, and also that the work that we've done to make sure that sports governing bodies have a clear set of minimum operating requirements and standards, and that they know how to support affiliated clubs, implement those, plus get advice and support around training, has made some progress. For us, the key point in our written evidence, and I would also just like to make this point, is that this is about culture, and it is about leadership, and it's about transparency, so that we all take responsibility to ensure that whenever we're uncomfortable about the way that children are treated or viewed, whether it's in sport or any other part of society, that we're all taking responsibility to speak out on their behalf and call it out in a really open and transparent way. And a further issue would be that the submission that we pulled together highlighted that when children do speak out, we still have a situation where, as has been noted in the historic issues, when they talked about what happened to them, one, nobody listened or did anything about it, and two, all of the adult survivors of that historic abuse still talk about the lack of support available to them to recover. They all talk about the lifelong impact it's had on their relationships, their careers, their lives throughout, and we still have that same issue in Scotland today. So with all the systems that we've talked about putting in place, we still have an issue where when children do talk about the abuse that they've suffered, there's still a huge delay in them accessing the support to recover. And we would also like to make sure that the committee take that on board in its thoughts and findings.
Okay, Claire.
Thank you again, Convener. I just wanted to go back to something that the Commissioner mentioned there. You said specifically there about control of children, a use of language which is very powerful and really quite disturbing when describing the relationship that children have with professional football clubs, I think was specifically what you were talking about, well, certainly football clubs. And I was wondering if perhaps the children's charities, who are advocates for children's rights, if they have a view on your use of language there, and if they agree with the viewpoint you have.
Okay.
It's not something we have specific experience of, but of course share the concern that children, we've heard a lot about the dynamics within football and sports and how children, you know, how compliance can be used. Children want to please, they want to be picked for the team, they want to be a success. That's not something that we have particular knowledge of, but of course advocate that children's rights need to be respected throughout, wherever they're involved in community activities, be it sport or otherwise, and also that empowering children and parents to be able to question the relationships, the power dynamics within those relationships would be incredibly important. I think we've come a long way, as we've previously said, but there's clearly much still to be to be done.
Matt, you want to come in on that point?
I suppose, again, we don't have detailed knowledge of what's going on in professional football clubs, but what I would say is that I spoke earlier about the reality that children are being sexually abused, and there are children right now, many children across Scotland who have been abused sexually and haven't been able to speak to anybody, and that's a reality. But the wider context for that has to tell us something about how we value children, about how difficult it is for children who have been abused to feel that they can speak out and they will be listened to and they will be heard. So my comment is, in response to the question, is that, you know, we have to think very carefully about the way that we show that we think about children and we put children at the centre and we think about their well-being and their protection. And that manifests itself in many ways, including, I do agree with the point that we need to talk about children positively, but that's part of realising their rights. And it's not just to think about them as vulnerable, but they are wholly dependent on adults for their protection. And so I would agree that where we see power imbalances and a reluctance to take on board that children's well-being should be at the centre of people's thinking, that that's a matter of concern.
Yes, Lorne.
I suppose child protection in its widest points, I think it would be useful to note that where there are concerns, we do have a positive situation in Scotland just now where we have a shared responsibility and accountability between local authorities, the NHS and the police in terms of the actions that can be taken around that child when an issue is identified, which is underpinned by the Getting It Right for Every Child principles, which were mentioned earlier by the SFA and also run through Children First training, I believe, and I think that is a policy which Scotland as a nation has worked very hard towards in terms of identifying the well-being of children. Inclusion is one of the scenari was mentioned earlier on when the SFA gave evidence, and I do think that there is a need to recognise the widest protection that's available to children and what is in place to support them. And I think that collective responsibility is something that is positive in Scotland at the moment.
Ivan.
Yeah, it was just a couple of points of clarification from earlier on. I know Tam talked about, I applaud the work you're doing with professional football clubs, because this situation where they can stop the kids playing for their school team or another team while they're under their control is something I think has always been a problem. But just to be clear, you're talking specifically in terms of the control aspect that Claire Hawley talked about earlier on, the balance of power thing. You're primarily focused there on the professional football clubs, which obviously is quite a small percentage of the total number of kids that are playing football, obviously. Or are you talking about it in a wider sense than that?
Just to be clear, mm-hmm. they can now play for their school teams.
Yeah, which is great, yeah. Yep.
As a result of last year, mm-hmm. that's 6 years after the raising of the petition.
Yeah, absolutely. No, no, so I applaud the work on that.
The aspects that still cause concern are about children who are age 15, who will be held to contracts
yeah.
at the behest of the club. Because of some notion that their talents may blossom between 15 and 17, and the club essentially would want them on their books.
Yes.
There's also issues in regard to minimum wage, about whether the clubs are actually paying minimum wage. My interest is for children who are under the age of 18, so it's in 16, 17-year-olds. And there are now growing concerns on my part, which I've raised with the SFA and the SPFL, about agents who are unregulated, who don't really require any checks at all, other than a declaration, who we don't really know the extent of it, because nobody's properly looking into it. Mm-hmm. And maybe, as Andrew says, the review will actually shed some light on that.
Yeah, no, I understand, and I appreciate what you're doing there. But just to make the point, your focus is very much on professional football clubs where it is a big issue, but it's clearly it's a very, very small number of children we're talking about. And I just don't feel to get the impression that that's something that you're talking about in terms of all kids.
And even within professional football clubs, you've got thousands of people who freely give of their time. Yeah. And the game relies on all of that.
Sure.
But they are the leaders.
Absolutely.
They are they set the standards, or they should set the standards for everybody else. So they have a particular responsibility. But they also are operating in a field where money becomes a very valuable commodity. And in fact, so do the children, if they're shown any talent. So it's those issues which really the Petitions Committee will be grappling with later this week. But my strong view is that the football authorities have gone as far as they are willing or capable within their structures in terms of that balance of the rights of children versus the investment in the clubs.
That's clear. I just want to clarify that. Thanks.
It's within professional football.
That's fine. The other point I was going to make was round about the issue of people working or supporting the voluntary activity who aren't PVG checked. And is there a grey area there, and you can maybe clarify this for me, where if you're a parent, you come along to watch the sport, but before you know it, you're helping out in some way, shape or form. I mean, you go to watch the kids playing football, and before you know it, somebody's given you a flag and told you to run up and down and pretend you know the offside rule. And if you kind of cross the line at that point, or you're giving the kids a run back home or whatever, is there an issue there about the clarification of where that line is?
I'm commending that then. I think obviously you want to encourage parents to be undertaking that. You want to create a culture where people are helping out and, and that you build relationships, social capital if you like, trusted relationships between people. You then have to apply the system of PBG as it's designed to. About once you move into roles which are regulated and have a degree of trust and responsibility, then you move beyond just a parent helping into the compliance of the protection system. There's other things, you know, there's a duty of care, I would say. I think there's a legal duty of care. I've discussed this with a solicitor. If you're driving some, as a parent, some kids from A to B, then you've got a duty of care to drive carefully and take care of them. So there's other sort of kind of protections that can come into play here. But I think the tragedy is if people feel I can't really help out because I've not got a PVG and all people suspect me and so on, and that's the toxic part that we've got to try and avoid at all costs, whilst at the same time be aware, as David Little had said, about the common sense knowledge and people talking with each other about whether or not an individual's showing the signs of being somebody that's a danger. And I think we're very capable of picking that up, not least by children, you know, being able to be talking as well about what their experiences are. So it's going to be a difficult balancing act to ensure participation in a context where we manage the risks.
Thanks.
Can I ask the police representative, in relation to people coming forward, have you seen a spike in people coming forward from other sports, from other areas of society, following the, you know, obviously the media interest in this and what's happened?
So we've seen now over 130, we've had 130 plus referrals in relation to football since November. Those are people with information about child sexual abuse in football, and also those who wish to report that it has happened to them. So we've seen a real spike in relation to football. Not in relation to other sports, in truth. And if I'm being honest, that causes me some concern. I think that points back to the culture I described previously, where we still haven't got a situation in which information is being brought forward, where those who have been abused feel confident that they'll be listened to. So an increase in relation to football, but not in relation to other sports.
Yeah, okay. Marie, did you want a final point on adults?
Yes, I guess I was struck as I was reading. I used to work in psychiatry, and I was struck as I was reading through all of the submissions that there was a great deal more protection for children than there was for vulnerable adults in terms of the law. And I just wondered if people around the table thought that that was an anomaly that needs to be looked at, or again, you know, I'm conscious that we really don't want to discourage people from getting involved in coaching and encouraging everyone in society to participate in sport, but it did seem that there was a disparity there, and I wonder if people had comments on that.
We'd say on that is that particularly adults with learning disabilities who are involved in sport and community activity, as we want them to be more engaged in ordinary community activities, there's no doubt that there are additional risks there, and that it can be harder to get into some of the nuances that we heard about earlier around power imbalance, whether or not relationships are exploitative or consensual. So I think there is some similar factors that play out amongst the sexual exploitation of vulnerable adults that we can see within children, and we do need to think about how we protect that particular group. And we can learn a lot from some of the systems and processes actually that we've put in place. But I mean, I welcome this idea of proportionate protection for most people, for most of us to be connected to our communities and to activities within those communities, whether it's through sport or other activities. It's incredibly important and acts for a lot of people as a protective factor. There is, of course, a risk there. But, you know, we all send our children off every day to play with people in their, you know, stay overnight in friends' houses. We have to be proportionate that we allow children and all the rest of us to connect with each other and live in a community where we value each other and what we can bring, and not shut things down so much that we actually end up having unintended consequences, which are also harmful. So it's about robust and proportionate systems. But the biggest thing that I think we've heard today is that it's about attitudes, culture, values, the way that we view rights, and that we have to get a lot more comfortable as a society and being able to discuss these things in a really open and transparent fashion. We should not make victims feel ashamed or blamed or guilty about what's happened to them.
Okay, what I was going to do just to final is give everybody their 10 seconds or 20 seconds each if they want, just to make a final statement or point, and for us to consider when we finish this session and for us to stimulate our further discussion. So I'll do that for the people who've been invited and not for the members, or we'll be here all day. Kim.
Thank you, convener. I guess from our point of view, there are probably a couple of different things, and it's been a really interesting discussion today, and thanks to the committee for inviting us along. I think fundamentally our members, the governing bodies, all support, and hopefully there's some reassurance to the committee in there, both the principle and the culture that the well-being of every child is at the heart of everything we all do, and that it's everyone's responsibility. So I think there's a really important point about that I'm sure we all share, but again is shared amongst our membership. So hopefully, convener, there's some reassurance in there. I think today we've also talked a little bit about the minimum operating requirements. I know there's been a lot about PBG, both in this session and the session before that. From the experience of our members, the minimum operating requirements have been developed by the industry experts, our colleagues at Safeguarding and Sport. And that's a nationwide systematic approach to trying to make sure that we raise the standard of making sure there's safety in for our children and what they do. And again, I know that in partnership with Sport Scotland, our colleagues at Children First are working hard to see how we can further raise that. So again, there's some assurance there that this is a nationwide systematic approach. There's a lot happening here, and I just want to provide a little focus on that. I think, again, we've talked a little bit about access and not barriers, and I think that's really important. The opportunity that our members work towards is that every person should have opportunity to enjoy their sport in a fun and safe environment. So that opportunity remains at the heart of everything that we do. Is there more that we can do? Quite possibly, and there are experts in that area more than I am. But again, I think that accessibility and that lack of barrier remains a primary focus. And part of that, again, we've heard a little bit today about the benefits and sport as a force for good, I think was one of the phrases used. And that's something I think, again, we must all recognise, both in the work that the committee does in relation to today, but more broadly, there are a huge number of benefits to individuals, to society and to the wider Scottish population, let alone budgets, if we're all that bit more active, so that we don't want to lose sight of that, certainly convener in anything else. The last part I think I just wanted to pick up on was a huge part of the work of our members is in working with volunteers. So there are 195,000 people who volunteer in sport in Scotland. That's more than in any other area. So yes, I know that George will probably clarify that it's youth work, but a huge number of those are through junior sports clubs. So there are 195,000 people there volunteering day in, day out, week in, week out to do something that they love, that their families love, that their children love, or that they just love seeing people involved in. So the proportionate notion that has come up today, I think, is at the heart of anything we need to continue to do. It's about enabling and supporting people to volunteer, which enable and support people to be active. That's something that is at the heart of civic society. So I just don't want to lose some of those principles, convener, as part of that. So apologies, that was probably longer than my 20 seconds.
Yeah, probably 10 times longer, but anyway, not to worry.
A few key principles, I think, to bring
sorry,
together.
Sorry, I did intend bringing Miles in before, so I forgot, so I'm going to bring him in.
It was more around the issue of culture, because I think every single person who has been here today and the panel before has said the need to change the culture. Now, to some extent, with the review, which the independent review which SFA will be undertaking, hopefully that will help change their culture. But as ACC Hawkins has said today, other people coming forward from other sports isn't happening. So are we going to have independent inquiries coming in the future when we find out, for example, if this has been taking place in swimming widely in the past historically? And I think that's where, how are we actually going to change that culture is key. But to some extent, do you feel there is a lack of movement to change a culture? You know, we've heard issues specifically with contracts, but widely for different sports, do they not want to be seen, maybe to be looking at this in this current context, which the Football Association has been brought to have to do?
I think, there's been mention of transparency, mention of leadership, mention of collective responsibility, and that's a responsibility that we share, that people share way beyond football. I was just actually thinking and preparing for my 10 seconds. I mean, one of the things I think that's really important is language and calling things what they are, because if you don't, you can let people off the hook. People think it's not important. So control is a really good example. I think Tam's right to talk about control. We've spoken about child sexual abuse. We haven't spoken about the rape of children, but that's what we're talking about. So this is a wider responsibility. I would encourage the committee to be really ambitious in your deliberations. I think we have got an opportunity to eliminate child sexual abuse in Scotland, but we need an ambitious preventative strategy. So we need to focus on football. We need to focus on policies. That's important, but we need to have bigger and greater ambition than that collectively.
Okay.
Just very quickly, has any organisations round the table today been asked to help shape the terms of the SFA's independent review?
Anybody? Yes. Yep.
Yeah.
Anybody else? No, just children first. Okay, you've now got 10 seconds.
Yep. It will be 10. Thank you very much for inviting me, and also for, I think, two really intelligent questions, dare I say that.
Thank
and,
you very much.
It's been,
you sound really surprised.
It's been very thought-provoking, and I think, in a sense, I hope you continue with that. We'd be delighted to continue the learning from this kind of debate and dialogue. But I do think there's a bit of a crossroads on whether or not you look at a system based on fear or a system that's based on trust. And I think we've got to go for a trust-building approach at the core of where we go into the future.
Just like to reiterate my colleagues' comments and say thanks very much for this opportunity today. I think I would like to finish by saying there is a robust system for safeguarding children in sport in Scotland. It's comprehensive. It's been developed over many years through a partnership approach, and it does continue to develop and strengthen based on good practice and legislative changes. This is multi-layered. We've talked a lot about PVGs today. That's just one component of it. The education, training, processes and procedures we have around child protection are the important components that will make steps towards changing the culture that we have in Scotland in this area. The system does, and I think can, react positively to some of the issues that have arisen, and Sport Scotland, along with our Scottish governing bodies of sport and our partners at Children First, take the area of child protection in sport seriously. It's a priority for us as an organisation, and it's an integral part of the support package we provide to our governing bodies to ensure good governance in Scottish sport.
Okay, Tam?
Of course, it's about culture change, and I really would. But culture change takes a number of different steps. And I think there's an opportunity to be looking closely at professional football. And the Petitions Committee has got that within its ambit. And I would ask this committee to pay close attention to whatever recommendations come out of the Petitions Committee. And if you can, throw your weight behind whatever the recommendations might be from that committee.
Mary.
Just to thank the committee again for the opportunity to come along today. I mean, I guess I would endorse other comments that are going to be made and don't want to reiterate ones that I've already made. But I would like just to, I suppose, leave you with this thought that a lot of children who will be currently being abused don't come forward still. They don't readily come forward and talk about their abuse. And that's often because although we have made much progress in the system, we've still got a way to go to make sure that when they do talk about their abuse, that they are heard sensitively and that we also have a legal system and a recovery system that allows them to talk about their abuse in a way that helps them describe it, you know, get justice and move on from their abuse as sensitively as possible. And we've still got a long way to go on those matters.
Okay. Forbes?
Just thank you for the invitation and nothing further to add. I think points have been made.
As I said sort of briefly there, I think important that we look at policies, much more important that we look at culture, and we need to get much more preventative as a society. As I say, I think that our collective challenge is to be ambitious in how we face into this.
Matt?
I welcome the committee's consideration of child protection and sport, but I would also say that this isn't just about child protection and sport, it's about sexual abuse in particular we're talking about, and we need to look seriously at what more we can do to prevent child sexual abuse across the board. And one issue is, how do we support victims? And Mary's spoken about that. And we'll be publishing research on how well we support victims later this year.
Lauren.
Thank you for the invitation today. I think from what some people around the table have already said, it's important to think of child protection as a system and not just the PVG check and not just the culture, but actually the wider culture in the widest sense. And part of that is national child protection policies translating down into practices and implementation on the ground. At every level, from local authorities to community organisations to sport, and in every sense as well, not just perhaps, you know, waiting for children to come forward, but actually training in place to help those people like teachers recognise the signs of abuse and be able to take that forward. And I think in terms of moving forward, continued collaboration around all of these issues is absolutely essential to move forward as one system.
Okay, thank you very much. Your evidence has been very helpful today. I think we all want more people participating in sport, and if our discussions have helped in that regard, then it will all be worthwhile. Thank you very much, and we will now move into private session.